This is VR and Cat GIFs. It is a book that I'm currently in the middle of writing. A little bit about me. I'm a VR evangelist. This is recording too, right? All right. So I'm a VR evangelist. That means I get to go out into the public and talk about the good word of VR and how much I love it and how passionate I am about it. I'm also the CEO over at Ensoverse. It's a little startup at the Commotion Labs. We're developing a real estate application for VR. I'm a designer and director. My education, I have a bachelor's degree in YouTube studies. I know, sounds weird. So there was a point in my life where I absolutely wanted to be a YouTuber. Like, social media for a good chunk of my life has been what I'm all about. And I think somebody's trying to get in. Hey man, welcome. Hey. In the past, I was the art director at Press Play Consulting. It was a YouTube consulting company that specifically made videos for big name YouTubers like, anyway, I actually can't tell you because I don't work there anymore. I was on Comic Shop TV as a senior editor for 4 years, and I quit all that to pursue VR full time. And it is by far one of the best decisions I have made in my entire life. And you're probably asking yourself, is this talk really about cats? And no, it's not. Cat GIFs is actually a metaphor that I use for things that suck up your attention online. Like, I'm sure everybody here has been on the Facebook feed and they've gone through and like, oh my God, that cat is so cute. I gotta like comment or like it because, you know, my day is a little bit better because I saw it. And I really relate that metaphor to, well, cat GIFs and people online who suck up your time as well. I don't know about you guys, but I've definitely been in the mood where I'm going to be like, oh, I'm going to watch 5 minutes of Casey Neistat. And then like 5 minutes turned into like 2 hours and I saw the last 2.5 weeks of his life. One of the first things I did when I first got into VR is I volunteered to CIFX, the Seattle International Film Festival Experience. And I thought when I did that, I was going to be playing video games that hadn't been released yet or like really cool movies with explosions and stuff because I came from a YouTube background and, you know, that's the sort of stuff that got made constantly. But to my surprise, I was actually helping people get into a multifaceted room with a bunch of different experiences all made by Nani Di Lapena. And she is an immersive journalist. She's been a journalist for about 20 years. And in this room that I was helping people get in were some of the most serious, VR experiences I've ever seen in my entire life. There was one where you were basically a woman going to Planned Parenthood. There was one where you were standing in line at a food bank in California and somebody in line died of starvation. There was a domestic abuse experience that the audio that you were listening to during the entire experience was from a real 911 call. And then there was a Syrian refugee experience that you wore a haptic vest, so when the bombs dropped, you could actually feel the rumble in your chest. And then you would hear the screams and crying of people running through smoke and debris. And my experience up until that point with VR had been, it's this cool thing that can, you know, be used for entertainment purposes. And going through a lot of these experiences myself so I can present them to other people really opened my eyes to, hey, there's something much more about this VR thing than just really cool experiences. The empathy that it can actually have on its user is groundbreaking and essential to the human experience. And so there are a lot of really big social networks currently adopting VR and AR right now. Social media platforms like YouTube is doing 360 video and live streaming in 360. Facebook, you can upload 360 videos and 360 live streaming and 360 photos, and then you have Snapchat, which wasn't always considered an AR application. When it first started, all those tools just weren't there yet. And then I started hearing it being called an AR application. And then I jumped on it, and I noticed something weird about it. The end user doesn't actually experience AR, but the creation tools for Snapchat is considered AR. And at that point, you have to consider, well, if the end user is who your target audience is it really considered AR on that platform? And that's where the concept dimensionality reduced content comes into play. And it's when you ask yourself, at the very end of the day, what tools are actually getting to the last person who touches that experience? Dimensionality reduced content can basically be broken down into like immersive content that gets downgraded to 360 video content, to a 2D video, to a 2D photo. One of the best case studies I've come across is Nathie. Does anybody know who this guy is? Yeah? Yeah? So his whole thing, he's considered one of the biggest VR influencers online. But the thing is, he doesn't make VR content. At best, he's a VR enthusiast, but he's best known for creating content with a VR narrative. And so, just like any gamer, he'll put on a headset, sit at his desk, and go, hey, we're being exploded, and you know, cars are chasing me, and I'm shooting cats out of a cannon. Cat GIF. And so at the end of the day, I have to go, no, he's not a VR creator, but it's weird to me how he got lumped into all these people that are actually creating 360 films and 360 paint imagery and experiences that you can actually immerse yourself into. And that's because right now we don't have a lot of people that are considered VR personalities. So that really brought me into my big idea. I was listening to a lot of Casey Neistat, or Gary Vaynerchuk, sorry, and he was talking about the marketplace, and he was talking about where does attention go. Oh, I love the skip. Does anybody know Eva? She's amazing. Yeah, everybody should know her. She's awesome. That's my buddy Aaron. They got really famous for this GIF. I absolutely love it. So the big idea was eventually VR is going to get to the point where we are going to have a lot of internet personalities that are VR specific. And you can already start to see this happen. And so right now I'm going to run you guys through like three case studies. The first one is Reggie Watts. Who knows who Reggie Watts is? Awesome. If you don't, I recommend looking him up. He's on Comedy Bang Bang. He's a TED speaker. He's a musician. And he's been doing live performances inside of Altspace. So on like a random Tuesday, you can put in a headset and go to his concert while you're like in your bedroom. And to me, I think that's absolutely fantastic. And you can join people all around the world for this single live experience without ever having to leave your room. The second case study I really came across was iJustine. I was lucky enough to meet her at the very first Vlogger Fair here in Seattle. And she was so nice, she gave me a computer. And I actually have a video of it. It's really cool. And so I was kind of looking at different people that I had met in my YouTube career, and I was looking at her, and she started doing VR videos, like 360 videos, specifically about her day in life. And one of the most popular ones she currently has is she's just like, hey guys, this is my workstation. And she just walks around the room of this work area, and you can see where she's doing unboxing videos, and you can see her like Nintendo setup and her editing station. And anytime she needs to get close, motion graphics pop up So you can see really close like what she's talking about. And it becomes a really engaging experience at that point where you actually feel like you're in somebody's home getting a tour. And then the very last case study that I'm currently looking at is Will Smith. He's this ginger, because when I say Will Smith, everybody goes, "Oh, iRobot, that's cool," or Independence Day. But when I hear Will Smith, I think of this gentleman, and he was successful at raising money to start a talk show in VR. And I think that's awesome that you can that we're at this point where you can get people together, build a platform to stream out to the world or record your movements, create an experience, and then share it with people as if they're there every single time. If you want, right now on Steam, they have the preview episode before the real series starts in December. I recommend it. They talk about Firewatch, which is graphically an amazing game, and they just go and sit down with the creators of the game and kind of walk through like what was their creative process and where did the aesthetics come from, and then they make fun of the whole premise of the game. And I really talk about those three case studies because it really brings me to my three types of VR personalities that I think are going to arise. The first one is called the maker, and that's somebody who probably has a background in video production, is really adamant about 360 video or 360 experiences. They probably put a lot of stuff up on YouTube. And that basically brings me to my case study of iJustine. The casual user or the casual VR personality is somebody who will use pre-existing technology or platforms to basically create their experience. So when I'm talking about Reggie Watts, Altspace already existed, and all he had to do was set up a time to have people get together and a digital stage, and he had a mic in his hand with audio content being fed into the experience, and there you go. You have a whole concert that you can do on the fly. And then my third VR personality, I like to call the designer. And that is somebody with the technical skills and background to build a full platform from the ground up. And so if you get higher end, I have to talk about somebody like Will Smith, who went out, raised the money, got a team together, and is building a talk show, a VR talk show, from the ground up. And so does anybody actually have an interest of like, maybe you want to do this? Because I do, a couple people. I gotta tell you, if you're going to start being a VR internet personality, now is the time because there's pretty much no competition. I was talking to a friend of mine who ended up marrying a very successful female beauty YouTuber. Him and I, we grew up together, and I was at his house and we were talking and I was like, "Yeah, what are you guys up to?" And he goes, "Oh, between the three channels that the family has and the beauty stuff, we have like 5 million subscribers." And that just like blew my mind. I was like, "Man, like, well, did it take off right away?" And he went, "Well, think about it this way. If you and I had channels that we had started when YouTube first became a thing, we would both have a minimum of 1 million subscribers." And what he wasn't necessarily talking about the amount of effort that actually went in. He was talking about being an early enough adopter. You guys all in the VR space right now are early adopters. So if this sounds like something you want to get into, I highly recommend jumping into it. Start grab a YouTube channel, start making 360 content, or start doing something where you can make experiences on a weekly or a monthly basis. So if you want to start making VR experiences right now, the first thing I recommend is jumping on every social network you can right now, because a lot of the technology that's probably going to come to the forefront in the next 10 years doesn't exist yet. So, but if you're starting to build an audience on Twitter or Snapchat or YouTube or Instagram, now's the time to do it. I would recommend telling all your friends and family first. That way you guys can have kind of your ground audience. Just start making cool stuff. It doesn't have to be, you know, the absolute best thing you've ever seen, because it really is a process. I mean, being kind of good at something is the first step towards being okay at something. And okay is, you know, the first step towards being great at something. Adventure time. If you find people that have similar interests with you, like say I was really into cars. I'm not, but say I was really into cars and I had a YouTube channel that had like 500 people on it, 500 subscribers, and I found another channel that had like also cars, but they were like car modifications, and they had like 450 to 600 subscribers. Then it would be like, hey, let's do something together where each one of us gets a little bit of content, and that way both of our audiences will now be introduced to each other, and we call that process cross-pollination. And it's a way for multiple people to jump on the same project or a series of different small projects and come out ahead. The last thing that I think is very important about getting started is to stay on a schedule. In the YouTube world, it's, you know, have a video out once a week. If it's Instagram, have something out every day. If you're doing Twitter, you're probably going to have like 10 different tweets a day, depending on the time, because that feed goes by so fast. There is no formula to making viral content, but you can kind of skew the odds in your favor. I was watching this, I was actually at AE Seattle, and there was this amazing video production company called Cinesource, and they basically brought this four area action plan to content that they were creating. And so the first thing is timing. They were basically covering subjects that were really popular at the time, which led to, you know, fandoms and interests. They were taking properties that were really popular and then making them really, really gritty and really, really dark, because there was a history of things like that working, and they decided to have an entire YouTube channel based on that. Last is access. You want to make sure that your content is accessible to everybody. So, like, was it Zach King, who's a YouTuber who got very, very, very big on Vine? He would do these shorts that were only like, you know, 7 seconds long, and they would tell a story, and then whatever problem there was would be solved by magic really, really fast. And he made a point to not have any dialogue in the majority of the videos that he was creating. That way, people in different countries that didn't necessarily speak English would be able to see them and not have an issue understanding and enjoying the content. And that was really integral to part of his success. He talks about going around to different countries and meeting people who didn't speak the same language, but they knew who he was because they were watching his content. And then the last thing you have to keep in mind is quality. Is it good? Because if your content isn't necessarily like, if it's just absolute crap and nobody can understand your audio and it's like low light, nobody can see your face, nobody's going to want to watch your content. So having just even a basic amount of information where you can create a presentation that is worthwhile to somebody enjoying, that'll be just part of to your success. And if you're going to do this in the VR world, you might as well do it right. There definitely is a difference between creating content and creating an experience. Content for me is something that's just filler. It's hey, we have a deadline, but we don't have anything for it. Let's bust something out really quick. It's not going to be well known, and you're probably not going to want to advertise it or make it well known, but just having that steady flow of content will help keep your. Hey guys, come on in, have a seat. We're almost through. So the next thing is audience versus community. Audience is great and all, but if they don't feel like they're part of your world, they're not going to stay at all. I've seen a lot of YouTubers get like this big pitfall of popularity, and because they don't utilize their content to build a community, everybody leaves and nobody remembers them like 3-4 months later, and it's really sad. But if you can make a back and forth conversation with your audience, they're more likely to stay, and then you can benefit as a creator and as an experience maker because of that community. So if you guys liked what I said, or you know, caught the tail end of what I said, I do have a bunch of social media links. You guys are more than welcome to jump on and connect with me. I'm pretty active on everything. I try to get a video up once a week on YouTube. I'm shooting for 1 to 2 videos a week for 2017. If you guys are here and part of the VR community, feel free to add me on Facebook. I'm super friendly, or at least I like to think I am. Twitter. Twitter's actually a really big one for me. I got verified today. So if you don't know what that is, it's basically this little badge that says, with like, it's this blue badge with a check mark, and it's basically reserved for leaders in a certain industry, or you know, you're super famous like Barack Obama, Justin Bieber, somebody who's just a major influencer. And it was so funny because I was like super pumped about it, and then I was like, hey guys, I got verified today on like my Facebook, and a lot of my friends have like 400, 500,000 subscribers on YouTube. They're like, I've applied twice and I haven't got one. How consider yourself lucky. And I was just like, no, I didn't get, you know, I didn't get verified because of the YouTube thing. It's because I'm doing stuff in the VR community and I get to hang out and be passionate with people like you. And so like coming to Eastside VR is an absolute high for me. Thank you for having me. I figured a lot of my talk was going to be just industry based of where we might go. And I kind of figured a lot of what you guys are used to is like tutorials and how to create under the hood stuff. We're going to go ahead and we are going to make a VR experience in After Effects. If you've been to any one of my previous talks, you've probably seen me go through this whole process before. It'll just take a minute to load up. If anybody has any questions, feel free. So right now it's a lot of 2D tutorials on how to make VR content. And then I do have a lot of, I'm starting to make just practice VR content inside of like After Effects, specifically tied to like, so like earlier this year, last year, because we're in 2017 now, I was invited by Seattle Fashion Week to demo a VR film. So I spent a month of my life every day, 8 hours a day, to build this awesome VR experience called Journey VR. Hold on. None. Zero. Almost none. No code. So it's, let's see if we can, yeah, I am in the middle. Yeah, so I was able to create this entire experience in a month. It's a 10-minute experience. It required zero coding, but I needed to know Element 3D for After Effects, and then Skybox from a little company called Metal up in Canada. And basically, you get shot out of this this spaceship, and then you go by some oh, say goodbye. Say goodbye. Then you go past some planets, and then eventually you go through like an asteroid field, which is pretty cool. If anybody's looking for some really awesome music for their VR project, Adrian Ladelia from Frostchild Studios made this, and like I told him exactly what I wanted, and he sent like this 2-minute sample, and as like I'm listening to it, I'm just like crying because it's just so perfect and so beautiful. Kind of reminds me of the like the title music to Halo. No, what? I did pause it. Yeah, so. Okay, cool. So the first thing I like to do is start a new composition. Does anybody use After Effects in here? Oh, perfect. Awesome. Great. So we'll make a composition, 1920 by 1080. Uh-oh. What is going on? What? Yeah, I can't click. There we go. That was weird. So I'll open up a new composition, standard format, 16 by 9. Go to new, solid. Usually grab something black. Call it E3D. And then I'll go to my effects presets. I don't know what the deal is. It's running really slow right now. Yeah. I'll go ahead and grab Element 3D, drop it on. Awesome plugin for After Effects. If you don't have it, I highly recommend it. Andrew Kramer is a complete boss. So what should we put into our experience? I have like a BB-8 from Star Wars. I'll just around. Maybe get another droid up in there. And yeah. All right, we'll do an X-Wing. I don't think these are the proper scale. Like R2-D2 needs to quit eating. Then we'll have something. Is it? Okay, cool. We'll just. I do have. There we go. Okay. So, and then, I don't know, maybe a hallway. A giant hallway. I'm going to go ahead and rescale this. Just so it can hold everything. Awesome. Now that we have our scene, I'm going to go ahead and make a new composition. And it needs to be a square composition. So Skybox can read it. 18 seconds. We just need an example. So we'll make it 1 second long. Go ahead, grab a new layer. Solid, 1000, 1000. Awesome. And then I'll grab all the content from here. And the reason why I do the 16 by 9 before jumping over to the square composition is because I like to have more room to move and work. And it just feels more natural for me because that's what I'm normally working in. So I'm going to copy it and paste it over. I'm going to grab a new camera. Layer new camera. Go ahead and move it around. Welcome. What? I can't hear you. What? Nope, totally forgot, but that's okay. Now, when I'm happy with my scene, I'll go over to File, and I'll go over to Scripts, and I'll go to Skybox Creator. And it'll go ahead and read the scene, and I can hit Generate Skybox, where I want to use 3D new camera. I am using a 3D plugin. And once that's done, it'll actually do all the math for me and creates a ecto-rectangular map. And from there, I can render it out, and I can add metadata, and I can upload it to YouTube or 360 VLC player, and it'll play just perfectly for me. All right. Anyway, that's I want to give you guys a little tutorial about some of the stuff I do. That's pretty much it. If you have any questions, I'd love to take them. Oh, I need to update everything. It's a really old version.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah.
It would be annoying and ask they use the mic.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, yeah. So those elements that you showed us, did you create those yourself or did you just download them? Or?
No. So the guy who owns Video Copilot actually worked on the Star Wars movies.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so those are actually the same models that I think he used for A New Hope or The Force Awakens.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. How easy or hard is it to build some of these and put them in and integrate those?
Like, I'll build a full scene animated and everything in like 2-3 hours.
Okay. And you have tutorials for these on your YouTube channel?
Yeah, I do. On my YouTube channel, I actually have a 3-part series where it'll show you exactly how to make an experience in Element 3D, and then it'll go through Skybox, and then how to tie it all in and actually upload it to your final platform.
Cool. Thank you.
Cool.
Anybody else? Questions?
So this would be great for making skyboxes for Unity. Can you output really high resolution from this using that plugin?
Yeah.
Like 16K?
Yeah.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah. Well, if you're using Element 3D, you can actually reset the map for it, and then you can scale it up because it's all math-based. It stretches perfectly, and then you can just export it. Yeah.
Okay. There you go. I just was wondering if you could give a list of all the tools and plugins and add-ons that you use to create this, just so that I don't miss anything.
So my YouTube channel actually has, like, I'll go ahead and tweet it out after the meeting. But my YouTube channel specifically has a, hold on. Do, 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 do. So Make, VR, and After Effects, this three-part series right here, will actually run through more in depth everything I just had, everything I just said. Yeah. Who's next?
Questions?
Saw a hand over here somewhere.
So, example, let's say if I had an FBX file or an objective file,
okay,
would that go, can that go directly into After Effects, or do I have to use something?
No, I would use Cinema 4D for an FBX file. But if you convert it over to an OBJ, you can actually upload. Actually, Cinema 4D files or OBJ files are accepted formats for Element 3D. I would recommend a Cinema 4D file over OBJ, just because sometimes the settings get lost. But if you have it in a Cinema 4D file, it's just easier to be accepted.
So let's say if I would then use like Skybox, the plugin, then I would be able to basically set key frames where it's able to just navigate through the space, correct? Yeah. Into After Effects, is that within
Cinema 4D? No. So basically, 4D? What it does is, because you have a 3D scene inside of Element 3D, mm-hmm, basically what it's doing is setting up a 6-camera rig, and then it's taking all of those, creating a cubic map, and then taking that cubic map and exporting it into an exorectangular map, which is the final format for a sphere when you're uploading it to a platform. So you can actually, so all 6 of those cameras are tied to a single null, and then you just animate the null through ZSpace or
In Adobe After Effects.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. All right.
I know, cool, right? Yeah.
Anybody
else? Okay.
Are you able to make VR like 360 videos or anything like that just using Blender?
You know what? I don't know, because I don't use Blender that often. Like, I know it's free, and I'd be really surprised if there wasn't a way to do that right now. I'd be really surprised if there wasn't.
So right now you're telling me I have to buy him this program to let him do that?
Blender's actually free, and I'm sure with a little bit of research you can figure it out. After Effects is a monthly service that you're paying for, and then Skybox is like, the newest version is like $300 if you do V2. And then, do you know how much Element 3D? Yeah. $199. Oh, you're already on it.
I'm already thinking the question's coming.
Yeah, sure.
So Blender is totally free. You can create the models like the.
Yeah.
At least if you want to do it in After Effects, use Blender for
it. Yeah. After Effects doesn't actually have any tools where you can effectively create models. You can do like extrude with specific shapes, and then kind of do a roundabout way of putting models together that way. But you're not going to have the same functionality as if you are in like Cinema 4D or Maya or 3ds Max. It's true. I'm actually part of that Patreon. I give like $10 a month, and over the last 2 years, I've walked away with $5,000-$6,000 in plugins.
Give away like $10,000. If you want to come just for the prize, that's
not. Anyway.
Yeah, so I'm interested in getting a camera to film 360 video. What would you recommend of the models that are out right now, and then what models would you recommend to look out for? Because I know there was some that came out at the CES, a few that were less promising than they were supposed to
so
be.
So right now, as an introductory camera, the Gear VR 360 is probably going to be my personal go-to camera. But if you're looking at like a Theta, I would highly stay away from it unless you're looking at doing 360 photography only. The Theta S currently has a skybox for video of like 1080p. So when you have it tied around, you're only looking at like 320 pixels to 240 to 360 at a time. So, and that's very low res. But if you're looking with a Gear 360, you're looking at 4K, so you actually have that, you know, 1080p in front of your face, and it's, you can actually see what's going on. And then if you're looking for something much higher, you might want to go like the GoPro rig route, and then pay like $2,000 to $3,000 for a Stitcher. Yeah. Sure. Okay. Oh, at the VR Seattle. Yeah. Oh, nice. Oh, I love it. I would pull it into Adobe Premiere. Adobe Premiere just happened to release in the last few months a lot of 360 video editing tools. And then if you're looking to like do stitch fixes and that sort of thing, you might want to check out Mocha Pro by Imagineer Systems. Mocha Pro. Oh, which you can win at the After Effects Seattle meetup. Yeah. Really? Is it just like people walking through the scene, through the stitch, or is it? Okay. Get a card for me and send it to me and I'll take a look. Okay. I think that's it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, thank you very much.